Hi friends, I am Dr. Amit. In this video, we will be discussing 20 questions on the topic of neuroimaging. And if you haven't attempted these questions, you can find the link to the PDF in the description of this video. It will hardly take you around 15 minutes to attempt these questions. So most of these questions are based on the AIMS pattern or the upcoming NEXT pattern, where the question will provide you some clinical findings and you will have to correlate these clinical findings with the imaging findings, right? So, I will start with the discussion straight away. So, let's see the first question. So, the first question is, the patient is a 37-year-old man who is a known patient, HIV positive patient, and is presenting to you with neurological findings like confusion, lethargy, and memory loss. Now, CT scan is showing you multiple supradentorial lesions. This supradentorial means in the cerebral hemispheres, right? So the question is basically asking you what is the difference between HIV encephalopathy and progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy. Guys, these are two CNS pathologies, CNS lesions, which are seen in AIDS patients. Okay, both of them are seen in AIDS patients. So let's see if we talk about HIV encephalopathy versus PML. Okay, so if we have to talk about these two, let's first important thing is what is the similarity? What is the similarity between HIV encephalopathy and progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy? They both will not have any mass effect. There is no mass effect. They both will not have any contrast enhancement. So both of them have no mass effect. Both of them show no contrast enhancement. So what is the difference? And here each and every word is important, guys. What is HIV encephalopathy? It will show bilateral symmetrical periventricular. Okay, here the pathology will be bilateral symmetrical periventricular. Okay, whereas for progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy, the pathology will be bilateral, but this time it will be asymmetrical. And instead of the periventricular thing, it will be this time it will be subcortical. Subcortical means peripheral, close to the cortex, right? So this is basically the similarity and the differences between HIV encephalopathy and progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy. Now coming back to the question, so which of these favors the diagnosis of HIV encephalopathy? Okay, mass effect, no, both of them do not show any mass effect, right? Contrast enhancement, both of them do not show any enhancement. Bilateral periventricular lesions, yes, this is the lesion that is seen in HIV encephalopathy and this is the answer. However, bilateral peripheral subcortical lesions, these are seen in progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy. So the answer here is C. Okay, moving on, next question. So this is a very basic question. So which of these conditions will not show diffusion restriction, means which will show unrestricted diffusion on the diffusion weighted MRI? So whenever we talk about diffusion weighted MRI, we have to know four lesions. We have to know four lesions, guys, which show diffusion restriction. Diffusion restriction is present in. Diffusion restriction is shown by, we need to know four lesions, four pathologies. Very important. First one of them is acute infarct. Acute infarct. Other is brain abscess. Third is aggressive tumors, like it can be GBM, that is glioblastoma multiforme, it can be lymphoma, right? And the last is actually a specific type of a cyst, which is known as epidermoid cyst. So these are the four lesions which we need to remember. They are going to show diffusion restriction. Okay, and these lesions which show diffusion restriction, they appear, we have to remember that they appear bright on DWI, that is diffusion weighted imaging. Okay, so diffusion weighted imaging is a type of MRI which is going to show these four lesions, at least we need to remember, which will appear bright on DWI. Okay, so coming back to the question, so which one of these will demonstrate unrestricted diffusion, means which will not show diffusion restriction? Okay, epidermoid cyst, it shows diffusion restriction. Acute infarct shows diffusion restriction. Brain abscess shows diffusion restriction. However, demyelinating lesions like multiple sclerosis do not show diffusion restriction, and that is the answer here. Okay, So this list is very important, guys. Four lesions which show diffusion restriction. Okay. Third question is asking us about the appearance of pituitary microadenoma on contrast enhanced MRI. Okay. So one thing we need to know about pituitary imaging, that for pituitary microadenoma, what we use is a dynamic contrast MRI. We use a dynamic contrast enhanced MRI. So what do you mean by dynamic? Dynamic means we are going to take multiple images at some intervals. Okay. We are going to image the pituitary again and again after some intervals, and we are going to look at the enhancement. Okay. And what is the characteristic appearance of a pituitary microadenoma? What is the characteristic appearance of a pituitary microadenoma? It will show less enhancement. Pituitary microadenoma shows less enhancement. Less enhancement compared to what? Versus the normal gland. The normal pituitary gland is going to enhance very well, and it is going to enhance early, whereas pituitary microadenoma is going to show less enhancement. So let's look at the options now. So what is the appearance of microadenoma? If it shows less enhancement, it will appear less bright. And less bright on MRI means less, means hypo intense. Okay. So it will appear as a focus of hypo intensity within the normal enhancing gland. Option A is the correct answer here. Microadenoma, because it enhances less on the dynamic contrast MRI, it will be seen as a hypointensity within the normal enhancing gland. Okay. Moving on. So question 4. So a mass is seen in the middle cranial fossa on the MR brain. Which of the features favors an intra-axial neoplasm rather than extra-axial location? So guys, whenever we see a brain tumor on an MRI or on a CT, what the first question that we have to answer is the tumor intra-axial? Intra-axial means which is arising from within the parenchyma of the brain. And extra-axial means that is arising from outside the parenchyma, means from the meninges or from the surrounding bones. Okay. So we have to answer this question. This is the basic question about brain tumors. Intra-axial versus extra-axial. So let me tell you about how does an extra-axial tumor looks like. Extra-axial means arising outside the brain parenchyma. So there are certain signs which we can look for in a brain tumor that will tell us that it is an extra-axial mass. First one of them is the CSF cleft sign. See, if this is the mass, there will be a rim of CSF. CSF cleft sign means there is a rim of CSF between the mass and the parenchyma. Means between the mass and the brain parenchyma, you can see a CSF cleft. That is the CSF cleft sign. And then very popular, that is the dura in the surrounding lesion. Surrounding the lesion, the dura, it will show thickening and it will show enhancement. So that is known as the dural tail sign. And this dural tail sign is actually most characteristic for meningioma, which is nothing else but an extra-axial mass. Okay. So dural tail sign. Then what else can happen? What else can happen is the gray and white matter, they are both pushed inward by the mass. Both the gray and the white matter. Okay. And plus, if it is an extra-axial mass, the vessels that are seen in the subarachnoid space, they are pushed inwards. Okay. They are pushed inwards by the mass if it is an extra-axial mass. Okay. And then let's come back to the question now. So which of the following features favor an intra-axial rather than an extra-axial location? So dural tail. No, dural tail is a feature of extra-axial mass. Rim of CSF between the tumor and the brain parenchyma. This is nothing but the CSF cleft sign. And this is again a feature of the extra-axial mass. Expansion of the cortex of the brain. So a mass is going to expand the cortex only when it is arising within the cortex of the brain, right? And within the cortex means intra-axial. So answer here is C, that is expansion of the cortex of the brain. And the option D, that is expansion of subarachnoid space. An extra-axial mass, look at this image. So an extra-axial mass can lead to expansion of the subarachnoid space as well. Okay. So these are important findings of an extra-axial mass, which will help us to predict what kind of a mass this is, right? So we have to answer the first question is intra-axial versus intra-axial mass whenever you see a brain tumor or a mass on the brain imaging, right? Moving on, question 5. So a 35-year-old woman with progressive deafness and tinnitus in the left ear. Okay. And the question is telling you that there is a mass at the left cerebellopontine angle. And the most common mass in the cerebellopontine angle is going to be vestibular schwannoma. Okay. And the major differential is going to be a meningioma. Right. And they've given you an image also. And the question is asking what favors a vestibular schwannoma over a meningioma. Okay. So if we look at the image first, this is the mass we are talking about. Okay, this is the mass we are talking about, and this appearance is known as the ice cream cone appearance. Ice cream cone appearance, and this is very, very characteristic for vestibular schwannoma, guys. Okay. So how is this ice cream cone formed? If we look at the cone and we, okay, so this is the ice cream cone. So this region of the tumor is actually the part of the tumor which is going to go inside the internal artery canal. Okay, it is going to extend into the internal artery canal along the vestibular nerve. Okay, and this is going to give the appearance of the ice cream cone appearance. Okay, and this is very characteristic for a vestibular schwannoma. This is what is shown in the image. So the question is asking which of the following features favors a vestibular schwannoma rather than meningioma. So both of them can occur in the cerebellopontine angle. Okay, the most characteristic feature of a vestibular schwannoma is the extension into the internal artery canal causing the expansion of the internal artery canal. So the answer here is C. Okay, expansion of internal artery canal. Now the rest of the options, dural tail, broad dural base and uniform strong contrast enhancement, all of them actually are a feature of meningioma. Okay, all of them are a feature of meningioma, but the most characteristic appearance of vestibular schwannoma is the ice cream cone appearance. The cone is formed by the extension into the internal auditory canal. Okay, so moving on. So question 6. The sixth question is again very, so this is what, how they are asking you the questions in the AIIMS pattern or in the NECS pattern. They will give you a clinical scenario and they will give you the image and you have to correlate both and reach at the answer. Okay, so 48-year-old man, 6-month history of muscle jerking, and there are some personality changes in the recent past. Now the MRI is shown, the diagnosis they are asking here, the muscle jerking, what they are giving is, this is the actually the myoclonic jerks. Okay, so in, especially in radiology and in most of the clinical based scenarios that they will be giving you in the exam, guys, there is a catchphrase. There is always a catchphrase in the question which we have to pick up, and that will help us to reach the diagnosis. And here myoclonic jerks is the catchphrase, and the finding in the provided image is actually, so this first image is showing you the cortical ribboning. There is this altered signal intensity around the cortex. This is known as the cortical ribboning sign. And this presence of altered signal intensity in bilateral thalamus, this is known as the pulvinar sign. Okay, and both these signs are characteristic for, yes, it is characteristic for Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, and that is the answer. Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, it is in the clinical history, it's very characteristic to show myoclonic jerks and rapidly progressive dementia. And on imaging, cortical ribboning sign and pulvinar sign are the characteristic findings. Okay. So moving on, question 7. This is a very interesting question. So 70-year-old man who presented to you with a clinical presentation of stroke, right? The presentation is left-sided hemiparesis and you are suspecting stroke now. On an NCCT, on a non-contrast CT, what we are going to see is we are seeing a low attenuation area in the frontal lobe having mass effect on the surrounding lateral ventricle and on the surrounding parenchyma. And the patient is also giving a history of CA lung which has been resected 18 months back. Okay. And the question is now, what is the next step in the management? Okay, now you are suspecting stroke. Okay, now if there is ischemic stroke, your next step is going to be thrombolysis straight away, okay? But see the question. The question is definitely telling you that there is some mass effect. The lesion is showing some mass effect in the surrounding parenchyma. Now, what we have to know here is that acute infarct is not going to cause any mass effect, guys. Okay? And plus there is a history of CA lung. Okay? So, what are we worried about? We are worried about now, is it a metastasis? So, how to reach the diagnosis? We can't just go ahead with the thrombolysis, because if it is a metastasis, it can be very injurious to the patient. It can lead to hemorrhage within the metastatic lesion. Okay? So, to reach the diagnosis of metastasis, we have to look for contrast enhancement. We have to look for the enhancement of the lesion. Okay? And that is why the answer here is going to be contrast enhanced CT. Because in this particular scenario, we have to identify if it is actually a stroke or a metastatic lesion. Okay? So, option A is definitely not right, because we cannot go ahead with thrombolysis. In a case of metastasis, it will be very harmful to the patient. CT thorax and CT thorax and abdomen, for the staging of any recurrence of CA lung, to look for any recurrence, this is a question we don't have to answer right now. This is not an emergency, right? If there is a recurrence or not. Right now, in the emergency situation, we have to answer this question, that if there is a CNS metastasis or not. So that is why the answer, the next step, is going to be contrast enhanced CT, and then further workup can include CT thorax and abdomen to look for the recurrence of the mass. Okay. So again, we have to go through the question again very much thoroughly, and we have to look for the clues. Okay. The clue here was mass effect, and the clue here was history of CA lung. Okay. Moving on, question 8. So the 8th question is, the 22-year-old man had a history of hypertension, was worked up, and what was found was an adrenal pheochromocytoma was found, and additionally what was seen was multiple cysts in the liver, pancreas and kidneys. Okay, so what is the most likely finding on brain imaging, guys? So this is how we need to go about it step by step. So the first thing is pheochromocytoma plus cysts in liver, pancreas and kidney. So what syndrome are we talking about? We are talking about VHL syndrome here. Pheochromocytoma plus cysts in the abdominal organs, this is a feature of VHL syndrome. Now the next step of the question is, what is the most likely finding, what is the most important feature of VHL syndrome in the brain? So most important finding is CNS hemangioblastomas. Okay, in the nervous system, the most characteristic finding of VHL syndrome is CNS hemangioblastomas. Okay, now the third step is, how do these hemangioblastomas look like on imaging? Okay, how do these hemangioblastomas look like? As the name suggests, hemangioblastoma. So these are very vascular tumors, guys. And the most characteristic appearance of hemangioblastomas is a cystic lesion with an enhancing mural nodule. It will be most characteristic appearance, it will be a large cyst, and within that cyst we will see an enhancing solid mural nodule. This is the characteristic appearance of hemangioblastomas, which are associated with VHL syndrome. Okay, rest of the options, multiple ring enhancing lesions with surrounding edema. So this is the description of metastasis. Here we are not concerned about metastasis. Okay, we are concerned about hemangioblastomas. Gyriform cortical calcifications. This is seen in which syndrome? This is seen in Sturge-Weber syndrome. Option C, gyriform cortical calcifications. This is seen in Sturge-Weber, not in VHL. Multiple calcified subependymal nodules. Very, very characteristic for tuberous sclerosis. Okay. So, this is basically a question of the various phacomatosis or the neurocutaneous syndromes. Right. Moving on. Question 9th. Now, this is a huge history, 18-month-old toddler with gait disturbance, developmental delay, and they have given us an enzyme also, a specific enzyme they have given. There is low level of aryl sulfatase A enzyme. Now, on imaging, they have given symmetrical high signal on the T2 images in the periventricular white matter. Now, as I just said, there is always a catchphrase, okay, and in this long question, the catchphrase is nothing but the tigroid pattern. The characteristic, the catchphrase is tigroid pattern, and this we have to remember, the tigroid pattern is seen in metachromatic leukodystrophy. Metachromatic leukodystrophy, tigroid pattern is nothing but the stripes. Within the periventricular white matter, you will see stripes. Okay, in that abnormal signal intensity, you will see stripes in the periventricular white matter. That is known as the tigroid pattern, which is seen in metachromatic leukodystrophy. It is a type of desmyelinating disease or the leukodystrophy. And one thing more I would like to tell you, the tigroid pattern is seen in another disease, another type of desmyelinating or leukodystrophy disease, which goes by the name of Pelizaeus-Merzbacher syndrome. Pelizaeus-Merzbacher syndrome. Okay, so tigroid pattern, which is the catchphrase, which describes the striped pattern of the white matter, is seen in two diseases. One is metachromatic leukodystrophy, the other is Pelizaeus-Merzbacher syndrome. Okay, even if we don't remember the enzymes, we must remember the imaging catchphrases, the imaging findings. Okay, next question. So this is actually a question more based on imaging, on anatomy, but there is an imaging correlate here. So what is happening is, an elderly male is presenting to you with an acute MCA infarction, middle cerebral artery infarction is there, and after 3 hours we have done a non-contrast CT, and in that non-contrast CT we are seeing the basal ganglia are obscured. So if we look at this image, guys, so on the right side, we can make out the basal ganglia. The basal ganglia are normally seen on the right side, but on the left side, if you can see, the basal ganglia are not differentiated. They are not differentiable from the white matter. Okay. So this sign is known as the, disappearing basal ganglia sign. Disappearing basal ganglia sign, and this is a sign of acute infarct on a non-contrast CT. Okay, this is a sign of acute infarct on a non-contrast CT, but the question is actually not about that. The question is asking you which of these arteries are the most likely to be involved for this appearance of the basal ganglia. Okay, now the question is already telling you this is an MCA infarct, acute middle cerebral artery infarct. So what we have to know is, the artery, the branch of the MCA which is going to supply the basal ganglia, and the answer here is actually lenticulostriate arteries. Okay, now anterior choroidal artery, the rest of the options, the anterior choroidal artery also supplies some part of the basal ganglia and the internal capsule, but however, this is a branch of the internal carotid artery, not the middle cerebral artery. Okay, similarly, recurrent artery of Hubner also will supply some part of the caudate nucleus and the internal capsule, but again, this is a branch of the ACA, anterior cerebral artery, not the middle cerebral artery. Okay, so that is why answer is lenticulostriate arteries. And the last option, angular artery, this is a branch of the MCA, but this is a cortical branch. This is a distal branch, which is not going to supply the deep gray matter or the basal ganglia. Okay, so this is how they are going to ask you to correlate the basic anatomy with the imaging findings or the clinical findings. Okay, moving on. So question 11. So this is a very basic radiology question only. So what is the best sequence for detecting the periventricular or the subcortical lesions of multiple sclerosis? The most best sequence, the most sensitive is actually answer is FLAIR. So guys, this FLAIR stands for fluid attenuated inversion recovery. FLAIR stands for fluid attenuated inversion recovery. So this FLAIR is the best sequence for periventricular lesions of MS, and you can just in simplest of the terms, you can imagine it is just like a T2 weighted image minus the fluid or minus the CSF. Okay, water is white on T2, right? But water or the CSF will appear black on FLAIR, and this FLAIR is the best sequence for periventricular lesions in multiple sclerosis. Okay, moving on. Question 12. So 65 year old presents with history of headaches and behavioral change, and this is actually an MR. So let's make it MR. Now this MR is going to show us a ill-defined mass in the left frontal lobe, which is going across the corpus callosum into the right frontal lobe. Okay, so this is the mass which is going across the midline into the contralateral frontal lobe as well. So the diagnosis they are asking, the diagnosis here is this appearance of this mass is actually known as the butterfly glioma. Butterfly glioma, where it starts in the one cerebral hemisphere, goes across the corpus callosum into the contralateral cerebral hemisphere. This is known as butterfly glioma, and this is very, very characteristic for glioblastoma multiforme. It's an aggressive neoplasm which can go across the midline, glioblastoma multiforme. Okay, moving on. So question 13, 17-year-old boy presents with paralysis of upward gaze, which is known as a Perinaud syndrome. Perinaud syndrome, guys, as we know, clinically also in medicine also you must have read, and if not, you can see the image and you should be able to guess the location of this lesion. So this is the lesion we are talking about, right? And just this lesion is present just, so this is the third ventricle, and it is present behind the third ventricle, it is present behind the midbrain, it is present just above the cerebellum. So this location is very, very characteristic for pineal gland. This location of the mass, as well as the clinical history that they have provided, Perinaud syndrome is characteristically seen in the lesions of pineal gland. However, this Perinaud syndrome is also known as dorsal midbrain syndrome. Okay, so since the pineal gland is present very close to the posterior part of the midbrain, that is the dorsal midbrain, this pineal gland masses, they are going to compress the dorsum of the midbrain, and they are going to cause this Perinaud syndrome. Okay, so the answer here is pineal gland. Now, next question, 19-year-old man with axillary freckling. Axillary freckling is going to show you history of recurrent hemiparetic episodes, recurrent stroke. Okay, and on angiography, we are going to see there is bilateral occlusion of the bilateral internal carotid arteries with presence of a lot of collaterals. Okay, so this occlusion of bilateral ICA with a lot of collaterals, this answer, this is known as the puff of smoke sign. Puff of smoke. These multiple collaterals which have originated because of the bilateral ICA occlusion, this gives a puff of smoke appearance, and this is very, very characteristic for Moya Moya. Okay, now the thing is that Moya Moya can be idiopathic, or it may be secondary to something. If it is secondary to something, it is known as Moya Moya syndrome. Moya Moya syndrome. And these, the reasons, the primary pathology behind Moya Moya syndromes, it can be secondary to neurofibromatosis 1. It can be associated with sickle cell anemia, can be with radiation. Okay. So these, if Moya Moya disease occurs secondary to some primary pathology, it is known as Moya Moya syndrome, and that is actually the diagnosis here, Moya Moya syndrome. And guys, what is the primary pathology here? What is the primary pathology? Please, again, this is the catchphrase, axillary freckling. So axillary freckling, which neurocutaneous syndrome is associated with axillary freckling? NF1. So it is actually a case of neurofibromatosis 1, which is going to show you the findings of Moya Moya disease, and then the diagnosis will become Moya Moya syndrome. Okay, moving on. So this is actually pretty easy, this one. 15-year-old boy presents with headache and bitemporal hemianopia, and the CT is showing you a supracellular mass. CT is showing you a supracellular mass. So whenever, make it a rule of thumb, if you come across, if you are asked a supracellular mass, so most common supracellular mass that is going to, you are going to see is craniopharyngioma. Okay, craniopharyngioma. So craniopharyngioma is the answer here. So but how? Now look at this CT image. This is the mass we are talking about. Okay, this is the mass we are talking about. So this black part of the mass is actually the cystic area, and the peripheral white part of the mass is actually the calcification. Okay, and the third important feature of craniopharyngioma will be enhancement. So if you see a cystic mass showing calcification with some enhancement, that is definitely going to be craniopharyngioma. Okay, and it doesn't have to be all the three in a single mass. Even if you see a cystic mass with calcification, just as in this question, you can go ahead and mark craniopharyngioma. Okay, so this is a one liner, which is the most common radiation induced CNS tumor. Most common radiation induced CNS tumor, guys, is meningioma. This is one liner, important to remember. Okay, so this is a question about the anatomy. So if this axial section, if there is any one section of the brain that we have to know on MRI, okay, one section of the brain, this section, we have to identify this section and the structures on it. Okay, so let us see this section once. So this center part, the CSF filled structure in the right in the center, is actually the third ventricle, and these two are the lateral ventricles, okay, or the frontal horns, and the posteriorly the occipital horns. Okay, then this structure present on both sides of the third ventricle, this is the thalamus. Okay, this is the thalamus, and if you have to look at this white matter structure just lateral to the thalamus, this is the internal capsule. Okay, so this is the internal capsule. Again, this deep gray matter, this is the caudate. This is the caudate nucleus, right? And if we go lateral to the internal capsule, we are going to find this structure, which is the lentiform nucleus. And within the lentiform nucleus, medially will be the globus pallidus, laterally will be the putamen. Okay, lentiform nucleus, medially will be the globus pallidus, laterally will be the putamen. If we grow even further, even lateral to the lentiform nucleus, what we are going to find is, we are going to find a white matter structure, which is the external capsule. Okay, so medial to the lentiform nucleus is internal capsule, lateral to it is the external capsule. Now if this is the external capsule, and if I go even more laterally to the external capsule, I am going to find something known as claustrum, which is the gray matter. And if I go even laterally to the claustrum, I am going to find again a white matter structure, which is the extreme capsule. Okay, so lentiform nucleus, external capsule, claustrum, extreme capsule, and then again a gray matter structure, which will be insula. Okay, so this is the appearance of the deep gray matter nuclei, that is a basal ganglia, on this axial section of the MRI, and that is what the question is based on. If on this axial section, which structure lies lateral to the putamen? Okay, so just lateral to the putamen will be, the answer is external capsule. Just lateral to the putamen will be external capsule, right? So very, very important to know. If you have any trouble remembering this anatomy, go to your anatomy textbooks and see this section, right? Next, so this is important again. 56-year-old male presents with a mass in the neck, and we have a CT scan which is showing splaying of the internal and external carotid arteries. So this is the common carotid, this is the ICA, this is the ECA. Okay, and there is splaying of the ICA and ECA. So this splaying of the ICA and ECA is known as the Lyer sign. Okay, and this is very, very characteristic for a carotid body tumor. So now we know that we are dealing with a carotid body tumor. And also in the question, again the catchphrase, the catch point is, it's a vascular mass. So carotid body tumors, we know these are vascular masses. Now the question is, how should the sampling be done? Okay, now since we are knowing that it's a vascular mass which is causing the splaying of this IC and ECA, it's a highly vascular mass, we must not sample, because the diagnosis here is not in doubt. We know, we are pretty sure that it's a carotid body tumor. So why do we need to risk the sampling, right? Why do we need to go invasively? Okay, so here both FNAC and core biopsy are contraindicated, because it's a highly vascular mass, the diagnosis is not in doubt, and we can go ahead and the patient can undergo surgery rather than undergoing a invasive sampling, right? Moving on, next question 19. So The description has already been given in the question. A hypoplastic cerebral vermis with hydrocephalus and a posterior fossa cyst. Posterior fossa cyst. Large posterior fossa cyst with hypoplastic cerebellar vermis. Okay. So which posterior fossa malformation are we talking about? This posterior fossa cyst with an enlarged posterior fossa is characteristic for, guys, Dandy Walker malformation. The answer here is Dandy Walker malformation, where there will be hypoplasia of the cerebellar vermis with the most characteristic thing is it will be an enlarged posterior fossa. Whereas in Chiari malformations, be it 1 or be it 2, the characteristic point is the posterior fossa will be small. Small posterior fossa, and there will be descent of the cerebellar vermis or the cerebellar tonsils into the foramen magnum. Either Chiari 1 or Chiari 2, right? And the last option, Joubert syndrome. Joubert syndrome is associated with hypoplasia of the cerebellar vermis, that is right. But there is no posterior fossa cyst here. And one liner we can remember about Joubert syndrome. It is associated with a molar tooth sign. Molar tooth sign seen in the midbrain is characteristic of Joubert syndrome and it is associated with hypoplasia of the cerebellar vermis, but not an enlarged posterior fossa, not a posterior fossa cyst. So answer here is Dandy Walker malformation, right? And the last question of this test. So in the presence of raised intracranial pressure, okay, so which of these brain herniations is going to cause the compression of ipsilateral third cranial nerve, that is oculomotor nerve? Okay, so let's look at this image. So these are the three important types of herniations we need to know. So first is subfalcine herniation, where the cingulate gyrus is going to slide under the falce. And what is characteristic for subfalcine herniation? The characteristic complication is compression of the anterior cerebral artery. Okay. The second type of herniation and the most important one is the downward transtentorial or the descending transtentorial, also known as the uncal herniation. Okay, uncal herniation. So here the medial temporal lobe is going to slide under the tentorium. There are a few complications of this herniation that we need to know. First one is the oculomotor nerve compression. Second compression is of the posterior cerebral artery. So ACA was in subfalcine herniation. PCA compression is descending transtentorial herniation or the uncal herniation. Durate hemorrhages are tiny hemorrhages which can occur in the brainstem. Because of the stretching of the brainstem associated with the uncal herniation, there can be these tiny hemorrhages in the brainstem which are known as durate hemorrhages. And the last complication of this uncal herniation, and very popular actually, is the compression of the contralateral cerebral peduncle. So contralateral cerebral peduncle, if it is compressed, guys, it will cause ipsilateral hemiparesis, right? It will cause ipsilateral hemiparesis, and this phenomena is nothing but the Kernowhan's notch. This phenomena is known as a Kernowhan's notch. Why is it important? Because it is a false localizing sign. Okay, it is a false localizing sign. Means the hemiparesis is occurring ipsilateral to the primary pathology, that is the uncal herniation. Okay. Then the third type of herniation is the cerebellar tonsillar herniation, and these tonsils, when displaced through the foramen magnum, they can cause compression of the medulla, which can be fatal. Okay. So coming back to the question, here the question is asking which is going to cause the oculomotor nerve compression. The answer is going to be descending transtentorial herniation. There is another type of herniation, that is ascending transtentorial herniation. Here this is because of a cerebellar pathology, which is going to increase the pressure in the posterior fossa, and the cerebellum is going to herniate above. That is the ascending transtentorial herniation. Okay, so these are the three types of herniations which we need to remember and their complications. Okay, so guys, with this we come to an end of this test based on neuroimaging. I hope you find it helpful, and please do give me your feedbacks and your comments in the comment section. I'm really looking forward to it. Okay, thank you. Keep learning, guys. Bye-bye.